everyone. It's Rachel Wolfson here at Consensus 2022 in Austin. Today I'm interviewing a very special guest, Caitlin Long.
Caitlin Long is a 22-year Wall Street veteran, and she has been a Bitcoiner since 2012. She is now the CEO of Custodia Bank, which aims to provide a unique suite of services tailored specifically toward digital assets.
Can you give a little bit of background about Custodia? It's a bank, obviously, yep. But just a little more detail there for our listeners.
Custodia got a bank charter in October 2020, and we're in the process of getting ready to launch to get what's called our Certificate of Authority to Operate from the Wyoming Division of Banking. We applied for a Fed Master Account in October 2020. It's now 19 months and counting on that. And then we also applied to become a Fed member bank. We complied with every rule applicable to us under the Federal Reserve's requirements, but we went even further than that and also applied to become a Fed member bank, which would make us directly regulated by the Fed. We did that in August 2021.
Got it. Okay, wonderful. Caitlin, obviously you have a lot of knowledge with the regulatory landscape, so I also wanted to ask you a little bit about the bipartisan crypto bill that was just kind of announced. What are your thoughts there? Is it good? Is it bad for the crypto space?
Well, it's so interesting because it split the industry, and some folks are really supportive of it and others are not, and I think that probably suggests that it's striking the right tone. I'm not an expert at it. It's a long bill, and there are a lot of things that are not directly pertaining to topics that I've been working on. But generally speaking, I think it's an important advancement because it's bipartisan. That's the bill to watch in Washington. There are, I think, now 50 different crypto bills that have been introduced in Congress, and there's only one that's bipartisan, and it's got the powerful senator from New York State, as well as the powerful senator on Senate Banking from Wyoming, which is the state that's leading in digital assets. That's quite a combination.
Right. In terms of innovation in Wyoming, because Wyoming is one of the leaders in digital assets and innovation, what else can we expect to see moving forward?
Well, the Select Committee is gearing up again. In fact, next week, the Wyoming Select Committee, on which I'm a non-voting member, is gearing up for legislative ideas for the next legislative session that's coming up in early 2023. And these are open public hearings. There will be at least three committee meetings. I know one of the things they're focused on is digital identity. And then, of course, Wyoming was the first to adopt the DAO LLC legislation to allow a DAO to register if it wants to be not truly decentralized, but wants to be able to get a bank account or open a brokerage account at a securities firm, et cetera. You need a control person involved. So it's not truly decentralized if there's a control person, but that's what enables the organization to be able to get bank accounts. Again, like it or not, it is. That's the law. So the fact that the DAO can register as an LLC in Wyoming is significant, and there were 50 that had filed to register in Wyoming in the first few months of that. So we'll get an update from that next week. But I know there are some tweaks that they want to do to that law as well. And then really, it's an open book. I think Wyoming has proven that it's a state that moves fast and supports this industry generally. For the good actors, of course, not the fraudsters, but it's if you've got ideas, come show up at the committee hearings. This is how the legislation, the ideas bubble up from the industry and it turns into laws.
Right, and I know there are a lot of DAOs now being established in Wyoming, which is amazing because it seems like DAOs, this is the year of DAOs, I think. So what Wyoming is doing is wonderful there.
Yeah, I'm not part of those. I love the fact that I'm not a gatekeeper. This is part of the design. There's no centralized authority in all this, right? We just, as an industry, just gang tackled this. It crowdsourced the ideas, made them happen. And I'm just thrilled that people are using the laws. It's so interesting because it's taken a couple of years for the big wave to hit, but it's really hitting. And I see it also in the special purpose depository institutions. There's a line formed to apply for those charters. And in the beginning, we built it and no one came. And now, a few years later, here they're coming.
Right. So it's interesting because I think that we're seeing new trends now. I mean, you and I have been in the industry, especially you, for a very long time. What other trends do you see happening moving forward? besides DAOs and like NFTs, do you see anything with stable coins or CBDCs or just in general, what do you see?
Well, the big topic, of course, is going to be stable coins. And I don't believe the U.S. is going to end up doing a CBDC. They're going to The Fed's going to put FedNow out apparently next year, although next year's only 6 months away and none of the rules have been revealed yet. So we don't really know what it's going to look like. But I think stablecoins definitely, this is a place where the regulators are going to play. And obviously the Lummis-Gillibrand bill, it was interesting to see how the Wyoming Special Purposes Depository Institution regime is in that bill, but also New York, of course, cares a lot because it's got the special purpose, the limited purpose trust companies, of which there are some that are stablecoin issuers, and basically that regime is what is being proposed in that bill. What will happen in terms of the law that actually passes? It's going to be a couple years realistically, and of course the sausage making process is not pretty, and lots of lobbyists will get their hands on it. And the banking industry, of course, I was very interested to see a long article about it in American Banker, very critical because the banks are very worried about non-banks being able to get access to Fed master accounts and to do things like this. And again, I put my hand up, we're the one who's done, who is a bank, who's been waiting for that the Fed has had our business plan for more than 2 years now.
Wow.
And I think there are more scams, unfortunately. And one of the things that is interesting about the regulatory backdrop is the regulators have had the opportunity to create regulated versions of these now. They've had Custodia's application since October 2020, and we're not the only one who's proposing to do this. Why haven't they acted? I do believe there is culpability for the regulators who have sat on the legitimate applications of parties who have sought permission while the scams have proliferated in this industry, and it's really tough. But I firmly believe the regulators bear some degree of culpability in that. They could have acted sooner, and a lot of people would not have been hurt had they done so.
Interesting. Caitlin, any final thoughts before we end our interview today?
We're at consensus yet again. It's in Austin, not New York. That speaks volumes, because obviously New York, you know, really sent a lot of this industry fleeing to Austin and to Wyoming and Miami and within the United States, for sure. It'll be interesting to see if New York gets it back, but it's crazy. Consensus is always fun. I don't see any Lambos parked outside here, but maybe I just haven't seen them yet. I agree, that's a good thing, right?
We don't need the Lambos.
Some of the craziness of this industry, it's fun, but boy, the outsiders look at it and say, oh no. And in a world where we're definitely going to have to, we're a little on defense because we're more than a little as an industry on defense because of the Ponzi scheme that Terra Luna turned out to be. And there are others out there. And frankly, good riddance to them all. I hope that innocent people don't get hurt. Not your keys, not your coins. Everybody needs to understand that. If you're holding your crypto at a third party, and especially if they don't tell you how solvent they are, it's dangerous, folks. There's a leverage flush coming, just like we had with Terra Luna. There's more coming. We are in crypto winter. I don't mind that as a long-term hodler, but I know what it's like to have bought into the top and then sat with losses for a few years. That happened to me back in 2013, 2012, 2013, 2014. But I held on, and here we are. And I think the same is going to be repeated again. So here we are. Enjoy consensus. It's crypto winter, though. I hope some of the craziness calms down.
Thank you so much, Caitlin.
Thank you.